Hi, I'm JD. I'm going to go around and, Hi, I'm JD. Sorry. Is the audio too loud? Hi, I'm JD. I'm going to go around and talk to some people about what their big emotions are. Joy? Anger? Sadness? How do they cope? Let's find out. Hi, do you have any emotions that you feel sometimes?
No.
You don't feel any emotions?
No.
Something that makes me happy is when I get to play with my friends and play my piano.
So describe an emotion that you feel sometimes.
Mad.
You're mad sometimes?
I'm mad all the time.
You're mad all the time?
I mean, I'm not that mad all the time, but sometimes I am really mad.
How do you deal with anger? Really? I've never tried that. Can you describe what anger is like?
When you just want to hit your pillows as hard as you can.
Give us your fiercest angry look.
I don't have a fierce angry look.
Try something. That was good. That scared me. Can you describe sadness for me?
Like when you cry and stuff?
I remember I was sad one time when my dog died. Have you ever had that?
I used to have a hamster and he died.
I'm sorry. What's his name?
I honestly can't remember. It's been so long.
Have you ever been sad? He's sad. You going to church this next service?
Yes.
What do you like to do back there?
Hide behind the garbage cans.
Hide behind garbage cans? Do you ever cry when you're happy?
Sometimes I laugh. Laugh too hard when I'm happy, and then I just start to cry.
I do that too. I actually did that the other day. What makes you mad?
When my brother's mean to me.
Uh-oh, calling him out. What does he do that makes you mad?
Everything.
Everything? Do you have any siblings?
Yeah, my sister's over there. She likes to annoy me by opening and shutting my door.
That would make me angry too. What do you do to kind of get out of that anger?
I go to my room for a little bit and read.
How long are you usually mad for?
Probably not long. Just when she stops, I'm probably not mad anymore.
Any other kinds of emotions that you feel a lot?
No, not really.
Very, very, very happy. Happy, 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 happy.
Good answers.
Well, good morning and welcome to Cedar Creek Church. My name is Luke Shortridge. I'm the campus pastor here at the Perrysburg campus. And we have been talking about our emotions, how God uses all of our emotions, even when they're up and down and sideways and everything in between. And today we're going to talk a little bit about the emotions of Jesus. You know, a couple times a year, we do something here at Cedar Creek called parent-child dedications, and we love to partner with families. And if you've been around Cedar Creek any length of time, you know that we don't baptize babies and infants. We believe that baptism is a decision that every person makes for themselves. So we do allow parents, though, to come forward in front of the church and allow their children to be dedicated. So this weekend, we have some families who are dedicating. I'm going to invite Mary Rizzo, our children's director here at the Perrysburg campus, to come on out along with our families. We do have four families dedicating this service. They are coming on out. Hi, guys. Welcome. We're going to squeeze in together here. We're going to be one close family. Beautiful. All right. Welcome, Mary.
Hello.
Good to see you down there.
I know. This is fun.
So, Mary, who do we have that's dedicating today?
Yes. So, starting closest to Luke, we have Josh and Maddie and their son, Kaysen. And their prayer for him is to grow up making his own decisions and always knowing that he is loved and safe. Then next to them, we have Tom and Audra and their daughter, Chloe. And their prayer for her is to know God and to have a relationship with him and to hold on to the teachings of the church and her parents while she grows up. And then next to them, we have Thomas and Laura, and their son, Preston, is a little guy down here. And their prayer for him is to find his faith and to not be afraid to ask questions. And they picked out a Bible verse for him, too, of Colossians 1:9. And then holding the little baby girl, that is Sadie. And their prayer for her is to find her faith and to not be afraid to ask questions as well. And her Bible verse is Joshua 1:9. And then our last family over here are Michael and Chelsea. And this is Millie waving hi to everyone. Hi, Millie. And Millie, their prayer for her is to always know that she is loved by God and her family and that God is always there for her.
Wonderful. So Preston is a runner. I would not be surprised if he tries to take off. He tried to grab a pair of keys backstage. But anyway, we are pumped to have all of our families here. And what's going to happen is I'm going to read a statement of commitment. And at the end of this statement, if you agree, please say, "We do." Do you commit to being parents of personal faith devoted to knowing God and learning to trust Him more every day, to receive your children with gratitude and joy, to stay engaged in a life-giving church, experiencing community and discovering your gifts to make a difference, to lead a faith-filled home that honors God in all thoughts, actions, and relationships, to raise your children with biblical love, instruction, and discipline, and to honor your marriage covenant and vows to pursue a life-giving relationship with your spouse? If so, please say, "We do." Wonderful. Well, we're going to go ahead and pray for our families right now. Please bow your head and pray with me. Father, these children are such a gift from you. God, we are in awe of how you work, how you bring children into our lives, into our homes, into our church. And God, I pray for these young men and women. I pray that they would come to know you at an early age and they would follow you all the days of their life. Father, we thank you for sending us your son, Jesus, and the example that he sets for all of us. God, I pray that Jesus would inspire these parents as they try to lead their homes with wisdom, with grace, with mercy. Give them your strength, God. So, Lord, we dedicate these children to you. We receive them as a special blessing from you, Father. We love you, and we praise you, God. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's give it up for all the families who are dedicating. Congratulations. You guys can head on out. We'll get these kids checked in. Preston made it. That's fantastic. Well, I am so thankful to be part of a church that can encourage families like this. And you all play a role in raising up the children of the church. So please feel free. Encourage parents, pray for parents, kind of in your normal prayer rhythm. It is so much fun to be on the life-changing adventure with each and every one of you.
Families are important to God, and they're important to us. As a dad of four kids, ages 5 to 16, I know that parenting is as challenging as ever. And we want to be a help, a guide, a resource through every stage of your kids' development. That's why we offer a safe place for kids every weekend, babies through fourth grade, with a group leader who knows them, knows you, and actually wants to partner with you when it comes to faith and conversations about God and questions your kids have, questions that you might have. Our middle school weekend experience provides fifth and sixth graders a service designed just for them, where they get to connect with a group of friends and a leader every single weekend. And once they hit seventh grade, we have a Wednesday night student night experience throughout the year where they hear a teaching specific to their stage of life and the things that they're facing. We connect them with a consistent group leader about their life that will actually hopefully travel with them with each grade. And of course, they're going to have fun together. We also want to help in one specific area for those raising 6th grade to 12th graders. We have a text campaign that you can opt into called 60 Days to Help Your Students' Mental Health. That's right. You can expect a couple of texts every week, both spiritual and practical tips as resources to help you and your student grow in your mental health. And as a church, we know that God is writing his story in the next generation, as well as in you, through every one of you. That's why each week we hope this weekend service will provide a spiritual investment into your life that will help you know him a little bit more. Before we move on, a final thought. In John 1, verse 16, Jesus says, "From his abundance, we have all received one gracious blessing after another." I don't know about you, but sometimes I need that reminder. Maybe you do too. That's why I love the time we spend together each weekend at church singing. It shifts my perspective, reminds me to see the gifts that he's given us. And it says in another portion of that scripture that every perfect gift comes from above. While the challenges we face are real and difficult, sometimes overwhelming in ways that we probably couldn't even imagine, let's take a minute to acknowledge that there are still good gifts like his grace, his love, and his presence that never change. They never leave us. And so will you stand up and worship with us together? Let's raise our perspective to him right now. Thank you.
the shepherd of my soul. There in the valley, along the narrow way, Lord, be the shepherd of my soul. Help my heart respond every time you call. Guide me in your truth and help me follow through. More than cold religion, I want you. I want to know you. I want to follow. Lord, be the shepherd.
Dwell in your presence, I will walk in your goodness. Every good gift is from you. And I will dwell in your presence, I will walk in your goodness. And every good gift is from you.
So much for singing alongside of us. You can go ahead and have a seat. So we are starting, or we're continuing on in our series called Mixed Emotions. And we're going to be just entering into week two. We're going to be hearing about how we can use our emotions for God's purpose. And so we're going to be hearing from our lead pastor, Ben Snyder. Let's listen together.
Here's your question. I want you to think about a pet peeve, okay? Think about a pet peeve. If you're watching online, you can tell in the chat or whatever. If you want to tell the person next to you, unless the person next to you is your current pet peeve, okay? Let's not get started on a wrong foot here, okay? Slow traffic. How many of you, slow traffic is a pet peeve? All right, me too. Thank you. You can be honest here. Nobody's going to escort you out unless you're a Bowling Green fan, and then we'll talk about it in the law. I'm kidding. Good job beating Marshall yesterday. Anyway, slow talkers. Anybody a slow talker pet peeve, you know, like the scene from Zootopia? Okay, a couple of you, right? Okay. How many of you have to deal with a rambler somewhere in your life? They create word salad everywhere. Oh, strong hands in the back. Yes, right. Okay. You know, I have a few pet peeves, too. I think we all do. You know, like when you go into... You know, this is personal, but you use the restroom and somebody just didn't replace the little toilet paper thing. You're like, okay, how am I going to handle this negotiation? Okay, it's going to be awkward, right? People who take too long, that could be a pet peeve. On the opposite side, people who are impatient, that could be a pet peeve. And here's the thing, we all have to deal with these things. Even those of you that are always joyful probably have a couple under the surface. And a couple months ago, it was over a meal, I and my boys and I were talking about something, and I don't know what started it, but one of my sons, I think it was Sam, looked at me or Noah, and they were like, Dad, you know, when I get a little older, I really don't want to mow. I'm like, mow the grass? They're like, yeah. And I'm like, why? And they're like, well, every time you mow, you seem so angry. Like, you're always stressed out and walking fast. And I started to think about it, you know, it's like, it's true. You know, I have a very narrow window to get the yard done and I'm hustling. And over this past year, I've just had a handful of ongoing issues with my, you know, walk behind mower that just make me, well, it makes me feel anger, okay? That's what I feel. And so today we're going to talk a little bit about this emotion that we all experience in some way or another. And I know some of you are less, others of you are more, and I have a feeling you all have somebody in your life that has to deal with this. So what is it? And where does it come from? And is it okay to be angry? Is anger good? Is anger bad? And what do we do with our anger when we are angry? And so, first thing, and some of you are like, how did he know what happened in the car ride on the way in here, right? You know, because I mean, I know when you get ready for church, sometimes you had some heated fellowship. That's what we call it in our house, in the car ride on the way in. Anger is an emotion. It is a part of the human experience. And here's what it feels like. We talked about this last week. It feels like a spontaneous mental reaction. It is an emotion, but there is so much more going on than just anger. And here's what's important for all of us to remember, for each of you to hear. Emotions are real. They are a real part of you. They are a normal part of the human experience, but they don't see all of reality. And so your emotions, even anger, can be helpful. Your emotions, here's the way I like to say it, they need a seat at your table. They just don't need to boss everybody around, okay? They don't need to make all the decisions. If you're into sports, they can be invited into the huddle. They just don't need to call the play. And so that's why last week we remember what first century pastor Paul wrote. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way that you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. And so don't just copy
what comes natural or what feels right, what feels natural or what culture says. No, instead, God wants to change or transform you. That does not mean make you void of human emotion. No, he wants to change you into someone who isn't driven by them. Okay, and so if he's going to change us, how is he going to do that? Well, what's it say? He's going to change the way that you think. Long before what we know about neuroscience today, and there's so much we don't know, but long before all of the writings and research and studies on neuroscience, Paul understood that God wants to change us by helping build new neuropathways in our neuroplasticity brain, right? The brain that can grow and develop over time. I mean, this is so profound. And this is not a one and done either. Some people think, oh, if I just pray to God once, oh, my emotional problems go away. No. This isn't a one and done. This is part of the life-changing adventure with him. That's why we use that word. Not just because it's exciting in moments, but because there are times where it feels risky and challenging. And so as you trust him, you're going to begin to experience God's Spirit changing you from the inside out. And then you will learn, what's it say? You will learn to know God's will for you. In other words, you're going to see God has a purpose for you. Like you are meant to be here. Like your life matters to God. And when you see this, and you begin to experience it in your life, you begin to experience God taking things that were meant to harm you and turn them into something that can be redemptive and good. And that's not putting lipstick on a pig or turning a blind eye to evil. No, he can just give purpose to things that were meant to crush. He actually wants to increase your pleasure in life and move us towards the preferred perfection that he intended at the beginning. So instead of letting emotions guide your life, pay attention to them. Yes, but bring them to God and let God transform you. So maybe you're sitting here going, well, how do I do that with anger? Like, how do I deal with the anger? So let's just start with what anger is, okay? Anger is a strong feeling of annoyance or displeasure. Anger is a very strong emotion that we all, like if you were to go around the room, we would all display this a little bit differently. But how many of you know somebody who has some anger in their life? You have to deal with an angry person. Anybody? It's okay. Yeah. How many of you, that person is seated next to you right now? Oh, some hands went up. We got some heated fellowship in the seats. All right. Well, wherever you're at on this journey, I'm so glad that you're here. And if we've never met, my name's Ben. I'm the lead pastor. So I want to welcome all of our campuses, people who are watching online and on TV. We have men who are watching at Toledo Correctional. Those of you physically here at all of our locations, we just put your hands together to welcome those who are watching online and on TV to say hello. So when we think of anger, I don't know about you, but our tendency is to think of this, okay? We tend to think of something that looks like that. If you've seen the movie Inside Out, you know, the foot is down, right? It's like, ah, that's it. And in our relationships, it shows up like this, you know? Usually there's some punching, cursing, throwing, hopefully not a lot of punching, but you know what I mean? These are the kinds of words that come with anger in our life, right? But what you may not realize is anger can also be expressed passively like this. And so here's what's interesting. There are some people who don't think they have an anger issue. They just stonewall. They just shut down. They just shut people out. That's still an anger issue, okay? So here's the truth. There are aggressive ways to handle your anger, and there are passive ways to handle your anger, but they're not necessarily effective ways to handle your anger. And so that's what I want to talk about. What's been so helpful in me understanding, whether it's a small annoyance or a larger annoyance, like this anger experience, what's been so helpful is understanding how God wired our brain to work. And so a little bit of science, and for those of you that are in this field, you may feel like I'm oversimplifying this, but for today, for the group that we have, I think this will be helpful. The brain that God gave us has many different areas, but there are two that I want to zero in on. In particular, the prefrontal cortex, which is the thinking brain, and the feeling brain, which is the amygdala. For those of you that are thinking water boy right now, I knew there was something wrong with his medulla oblongata. That's actually a different part of the brain. But still, you know, it's like it's easy to get all of these parts confused. Here's what you need to know. You need, if you're dealing with anger effectively, you need these two parts of your brain to play nice, okay? And so the problem is when you are triggered with an emotion like joy and fear and anger, grief, the amygdala floods your body with all sorts of neurochemicals. That's where you feel adrenaline or excitement or cortisol or dopamine, right? And so when your brain is experiencing these emotions, it's triggered, it's reacting, it's signaling to your body that something significant is going on. The challenge is the thinking part of your brain when this happens turns off. That's why when you're emotional, that's why when you're afraid, that's why when you're angry, and sometimes even when you're happy when your team pulls off an overtime win against Marshall, right? And you're all excited. You do all sorts of crazy things that you look back and you go, where did that come from? You know, I don't even remember. Because literally that part of your brain turns off. This is why emotions feel spontaneous, like they came out of nowhere. So when we experience anger, we are experiencing an explosion of chemicals here that turns off our thinking brain. And so effectively dealing with anger actually requires both. And this is where we get into trouble. We feel like we need to turn anger off, like anger is a problem. And so we try to resist it. And it's like the Hulk on the inside. It's just gonna come out anyway, right? And so the bottom line for you and for me that's so helpful is your anger is a signal, not a solution. Your anger is like an indicator light that's going blink, blink, blink. Hey, pay attention. Something important is going on. It's not a solution, meaning it's not the way you get what you want. It's letting you know that something important is happening. And the source for this statement actually comes from Dr. Henry Cloud. He's a Christian psychologist. He has incredible resources on boundaries and emotions. I actually include one of the links to his talks in my message notes. You can find that on the app. If you would love to go a little bit deeper, every weekend we provide all sorts of additional resources on our message notes right there on the app. Proverbs 12:16 says that a fool gives full vent to their anger, but a wise person stays calm. Anger is present in both, but the fool sees anger as a solution. The wise person sees anger as a signal. In James chapter 1, it says this, "You must all be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. Because human anger does not produce the righteousness God desires." It does not say that it is bad to get angry. It says that if you let anger drive, it does not produce the results that you want. In other words, if you just copy the behaviors and customs of this world, if you do what comes most natural, what everybody else is doing, it will lead you to unhealthy and unhelpful places. It'll disconnect you from God's good and pleasing and perfect will for your life when you let it turn into action. And so what's the solution? It's right here in the verse. Be quick to listen and slow to speak. And that will help you be slow to get angry. Listening is the key. And so the very first thing to do when you're angry and when you sense it in yourself and when somebody around you is angry. So whether this is for you or your kids or your spouse or the people around, the very first thing is to acknowledge it. I didn't say act on it. I also say don't ignore it. Don't should all over yourself. Like, oh, I shouldn't be angry right now and I shouldn't be feeling this. And don't should on other people either. You shouldn't be reacting this way. You know, you shouldn't be angry right now. Don't blame, don't shame, and don't play like passive aggressive sarcastic games either. You know what Dr. Henry Cloud says? He says to tell yourself, my anger is okay. Some of you are like, wait, what? Like, are you sure? Yeah. Your action, the action that you have out of anger, let me be clear, just because your anger is okay doesn't give you permission to yell. or throw or be abusive or demean somebody. No, that's action. The emotion, my anger right now is okay. Why? Why is it okay? Because it's a signal, not a solution. And so why is anger okay? It's signaling something important to you. It's signaling to you that something is off. For those of you that don't know, anger is a secondary emotion. What does that mean? It means it's always connected to something else. And so it's signaling that something else inside is off, is a threat, that something important to you is being threatened. The best way for me to visualize this is underneath every feeling of anger is a value that's really important to you. This explosion of emotion, right, that you experience, whether aggressively or passively, is indicating that something important to you is being threatened or isn't going your way. It's an indicator light in your life. It can be so helpful when you see anger as a signal. So when the indicator light goes off, that doesn't mean freak out and start reacting and pull a bunch of levers like, ah! But it also means don't ignore it. That is equally destructive. To not validate this emotion that you're having inside of you means you're trying not to be human. So when angry, see it as a signal, acknowledge it, and in the words of Dr. Daniel Tiger, when you feel so mad that you want to roar, take a deep breath and count two. And all the kids, parents of kids over here said the number. Yeah, you've heard it, right? And it's amazing because we look at this and we go, oh, that's for kids. Right. You know how many adults this would be helpful for? Like all of us, okay? I often wonder if they're just doing this to help us adults more than our kids. I mean, a deep breath is so helpful. Do you know why? Because it takes about 90 seconds for that first wave of chemical to kind of wash through your body. In other words, it takes 90 seconds or so just for the opportunity for your thinking brain to come back to the conversation. We're not just trying to treat you like you're a kid. Taking a deep breath increases the amount of oxygen in your body, which your brain needs to function. And it gives your prefrontal cortex time to re-enter your thinking brain, time to re-enter the conversation. Acknowledge it. Take a deep breath. This is why journaling is so helpful for me. Because I can sit down and just acknowledge it, and my journal isn't gonna get offended. And it allows my thinking brain to re-enter the conversation. And when you acknowledge, hey, this is anger that I'm feeling right now, then, and your thinking brain comes back into the conversation, then the second thing that you do is you get curious about it by asking the question, what's wrong? You can do this for yourself, but you can also do this graciously and calmly with the people in your life when they're angry. Hey, honey, I sense that you're angry. Can you help me see what's wrong? Put on some Teflon, right? Don't take it all personal. Like with your kids. Hey, you know, son, daughter, I see that you're angry. You know, what is it that you're frustrated about? And you're gonna have to keep staying curious and caring through all of that. But your thinking brain needs you to take a breath. If anger is a natural reaction when something of value is threatened, you need to get clarity on what that value is or what is wrong. And here's what's hard, is this is a lot harder than it sounds because your amygdala wants to blame whoever's right in front of you. Well, they said it that way. They didn't do this. They didn't clean up that. If they only would have, if that car didn't, you know, get in my way, I wouldn't be a nanosecond late. It's like you're putting your entire 20 minutes on the one car that got in front of you and went a little slow. No. That problem goes way back to when before you left the house, but I'm gonna blame it all on the person in front of me. It takes courage. Because our first response when we're angry, my first response is to blame or to get mad at whatever's right in front of me. And what makes anger complicated is sometimes our anger is caused by something that's good that should be defended. And other times it's triggered by something that's unhealthy. Here's the way that I diagram it. If there's a value, sometimes there's a virtuous value. Sometimes our anger is reacting to something that we should protect and defend, like standing up for the widow or the orphan or the foreigner, the rights of others, standing up for what matters to God, not in an angry and aggressive sort of way, but in an effective way. Sometimes our anger is virtuous when it's connected to things that matter to God. But there are other times where our anger is trying to defend a vice, a selfish preference. And so asking what's really wrong requires maturity and humility. I want to demonstrate each of these for just a minute. You see the virtuous anger with Jesus. He walks into the temple, the epicenter of where Jewish people connect with God and even non-Jewish people. And he goes into the Gentile court, which is on the southern side of the temple, and it's full of cattle and sheep and goats and birds and merchants. And here's what happens. It says that Jesus made a whip from some of the ropes and chased them all out of the temple. He drove out the sheep and the cattle and scattered the money changers' coins all over the floor and turned over their tables. I think it's safe to assume Jesus is angry. And so you may be asking the question, and people will often reference this. Well, Jesus was angry. I'm allowed to be angry. Time out. I don't know that that's a validation for any anger. What's really wrong here? There's a virtue that's being or a value that's being violated, a virtuous value. Then going over to the people who sold doves, he told them, get these things out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a marketplace. What's the real issue here? What's the problem? What's wrong? A lot of people go, well, they're selling stuff in church. Well, if you know the Jewish faith, you know they have to sell things. It's not the selling things alone that's the problem. It could be their deceptive practices. But the truth is, these merchants set up in the Gentile court of the temple. This is the only place non-Jewish people could worship God. They weren't allowed into the Jewish court or any closer to the Holy of Holies. This is the only place. And so when Jesus says, you've turned my father's house into a den of thieves, what are these merchants stealing? They're stealing the Gentiles' opportunity to worship God. They're letting their greed, their pride, their looking down on non-Jewish individuals or these individuals steal their opportunity to connect with him. And so Jesus is basically saying, hey, these people, they matter to God too. God is always making room for the foreigner and the outsider. I mean, this story inspires our mission at our church. Like, this is why we want to introduce people to Jesus. Because the stories that Jesus tells is that our God is always after the person who feels far away from God or disconnected from the church. And there are far too many churches pointing a finger at them, telling them why they don't matter to God. I mean, here's what's interesting. It goes on, it says, then his disciples remembered this Old Testament Jewish prophecy from the scriptures, passion for God's house will consume me. And this was an Old Testament passage that was related to the Messiah, and so the disciples are connecting dots, but what's interesting is this describes Jesus. A passion for a virtuous value consumed Jesus. Jesus had a holy, maybe you've heard this phrase before, a holy discontent. There are going to be times where you and I are going to be confronted with something that's wrong in our world, in our marketplace, in our school, or in our community somewhere. And we're going to need to stand up in a gracious and humble way for what matters to God. We're going to need to stand up and speak out and appropriately fight back against the injustice in our world. And you've seen this throughout history. When Christians stood up against slavery and racism and sexism and standing up against poverty and injustice. I mean, this is a key part, a beautiful part of the church. The church doesn't always get it right. But man, this is when the church is powerful. And so at Cedar Creek, we want to be for our community. You see this when we bring in Dr. Calvin Sweeney and his wife, Christine. We love partnering with the Tabernacle and the work they're doing through the Hope Center in Central Toledo. We want to partner with public schools. Each of our campuses is looking for partnership with a public school in their vicinity. Why? So that we can serve the families of our community. This is why we offer free medical care out of our South Toledo campus in partnership with UTMC, a part that I love about our church. This is why we send or invite you to go on mission trips, which have been on pause because of COVID, but we're firing up mission trips back down to Latin America to the churches that we're partnered with because we feel like the church is called to help those who are in need. This is why we help single moms with our single mom car care clinic. This is why we love streaming to TOCI and bringing Celebrate Recovery into Toledo Correctional. I mean, when you lean in with us and when you give financially here, it accelerates our ability to be for our community, to serve and support. And we should be passionate about them, those things. We should take a little bit of confident, humble pride, if you will, in that. That's a virtuous thing to be like passionate about, but not all anger is virtuous. Sometimes it's a vice. And I would love to say that I'm more on this side than I am this side. The truth is when I'm annoyed, oftentimes my anger, yeah, sometimes it signals something that we should care about, something that we should stand up for, but sometimes anger, again, not bad, is signaling a vice that God wants to change in me, sometimes in you. It's reacting to a value that I'm holding on to, that maybe you're holding on to, that needs to be replaced or repaired. James, the brother of Jesus, he talks about this. He says, what is it that's causing the quarrels and fights among you? Don't they come from evil desires at war within you? What are quarrels and fights? That's basically the outward action of inward anger, right? And what's the source of this? This is what's so profound. Thousands of years before we knew what mental health was and how our brain works, James is outlining that anger is signaling that there's some evil desires causing you to quarrel and fight with people. And what's wrong? Well, basically, you want what you don't have. I mean, in the end, the value is, I'm not getting what I want. We're like two-year-olds, and we just never really grow out of that to some degree. And I mean, there's some freedom in acknowledging that. Keep in mind, James is writing to Christians, not the broader world, right? These are people who say they follow Jesus, and they're struggling with it too. We all do. We are not getting what we want, and so our anger is upset because why? The value is we want what we want. And so we act out of that anger. So what do? Here's what James says. You scheme, you kill to get it. You're jealous of what others have, but you can't get it. So you fight and you wage war to take it away from them or to get back. And some of you are like, yeah, but I haven't killed anybody physically. Like he's not talking about me. You may not have killed somebody physically, but do you kill the relationship? And when you stonewall somebody and you don't talk to them, that's what you're doing. You're killing the relationship. You're letting your anger act out in ways that are destructive. Do you ever get jealous? And so it's hard for you even to care about them because, I mean, shoot, they don't deserve that house, that car, that job, that promotion. Do you know how many years I've been here? Do you know how much? You know your jealousy is really an issue with God? It's not an issue with them. You're mad at them, but you're just mad that God didn't give you what you think you deserve. I know because I deal with jealousy. What does it do? It wages war within us. Does that sound like you? I know it sounds like me. In moments, man, that is so my life. And so asking what's wrong helps me see, like, what's the real issue? And yeah, sometimes it's a virtuous thing, but most of the time, I'm angry because somebody said no. And what I really wanted was to control the outcome. Being a control freak is not the good and perfect and pleasing will that God has for you. Sometimes I'm angry because it isn't perfect and I'm a perfectionist and I think I want it right as if my idea of right is the only way that it should go. Being a perfectionist is not good, God's good and pleasing and perfect will for you. Sometimes I get angry, maybe you're better at this than I am, because I can't have what I want when I want it. So I get annoyed and frustrated that somebody encroached on me time. You see this in particular with addicts, where when they can't get whatever it is that they need, they lash out. They'll kill relationships over it. They'll betray and lie and steal. Sometimes I get mad because effort is actually required, because it might not be comfortable. Do you see? This is a vice. It's a weakness in character. And what's interesting is here's what James says next. He says, you don't have what you want because you don't ask God for it. So what do? Well, we ask God, God, solve this problem at work. And he goes on, even when you ask, you don't get it because your motives are all wrong. You only want what will give you pleasure. See, sometimes there's an inner vice that's keeping you and me from the good and pleasing will, the life that God has for us. And we're not convinced. We think we see it right. If you just give me what I want, if you just give me the promotion, the job, the thing, the girl, the guy, the whatever, then and no, God wants to transform you by changing the way that you think. And so if you want to find freedom from anger isn't the problem. You need to allow God in to help you think differently about what's really going on. And so how do you do this? Well, here's what he says. He says, as the scriptures say, God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. I'm sure many of you have heard this before. Do you know what this is telling us as it relates to our anger? If God is opposing the proud, if he's opposing you and me, when we feel like we know, we see, we're right, we deserve, if he's opposing us, you know what that means? He's applying pressure. And sometimes God applies pressure to our life against the vice, the character, and we can get madder and madder at God, or we can open up. And what's it say? He gives grace to the humble. This is why anger is so helpful. Because anger indicates, it signals that something is wrong. And sometimes what's wrong is you're holding on to something that God wants to change in you. And when you see it, you don't have to be embarrassed or discouraged. Why? Because God has grace for the humble. God, I've got a vice. I'm annoyed because I'm not getting what I want. So where do you need to get curious today? Where is it that God's whispering, like, hey, like you don't have to be annoyed all the time. You don't have to stonewall anymore. Like your anger isn't the problem, but it's that value that you keep holding on to. Like he's inviting you to find freedom. And I know, man, at first I want to hold on to it, but when you can open it up, it's a freer way to live. That may mean for some of you, you got to talk to a therapist or talk to somebody because you need help. That doesn't mean you're crazy and it doesn't mean you're weak. Man, it's crazy? It's trying to do it alone. So as you investigate what's really wrong, and as you maybe go, hey, there's a vice here that God is inviting me to work on, then you can ask, what's the wise thing to do? What's the wise thing to do in this situation? Not how do I feel like acting? That's not what this question is. And also not ignoring your anger. Oh, I'm just going to suppress it and ignore it and suppress it and ignore it. No, no. What's the wise choice towards what is of true value? Here's what James says. He says to humble yourselves before God and then resist the devil and he will flee from you. Do you know what the devil wants? The devil wants for you to get caught up in your anger. He wants you stuck and acting out with the people and with God out of this emotion. And he wants you to feel miserable for it and powerful for it all at the same time. But when you're humble, when you humble yourself before God, like, hey, my anger, it's okay. My anger is okay. What's wrong? God, what is it that I need to see here? When you're honest with him and others, man, it can change. And how do you do that? You just keep coming back. Like, what's the wise thing for me to do here? Because the wise choice may mean fighting for something worth fighting for. The wise choice may mean creating a little separation in an abusive or toxic relationship or workplace. Like, hey, I need some actual boundary here. Like, I can't keep dealing with your inappropriate behavior. That may be the wise thing for some of you to do. The wise thing may be to confront an issue that you see at work or in somebody's life. The wise thing may be for you to forgive, even if they don't deserve it. It all depends on what's wrong. This is why a life-giving group of friends is so helpful. I need people in my life who can challenge my motives and my internal world, who can ask me pesky questions about what's really going on under the surface. Because here's the thing, when you don't deal with anger and you just let it simmer there in your life, if left ignored, it always leads to resentment. Virtuous anger leads to resentment, and your vice always leads to resentment. No matter which way it is, not dealing with it leads you in the same spot. In fact, if you deal with resentment or you have resentment in your life, you're carrying some undealt with anger that you may need to get curious about. Self-righteous anger just believes I'm better than you, and the world would be a lot better if they just valued what I valued. And self-indulgent anger looks at how you've been left over or looked over and ignored, and so you deserve this, and you take it into your own hands to do what you want. That's why you see things like this in Ephesians. It says, don't sin by letting anger control you. It says, and in, other translations say, in your anger, don't sin. Anger is not the sin. It's when it begins to control your life. So what's he say? Don't let the sun go down while you're still angry, for anger gives a foothold to the devil. What's he saying here? Side note, sometimes it is wise to let the sun go down on your anger, okay? Staying up until 3 o'clock in the morning to solve some sort of marital dispute may actually just lead to a lack of sleep and more anger. Letting yourself sleep it off and talk about it in the morning may be great advice. The principle is deal with your anger in a timely manner, right? Don't let it become resentment, because that's the foothold. That's right where God's enemy wants you to live. He wants to keep you stuck there. And so you have an opportunity right now, like literally right now, to go, is there a space where I'm dealing with some resentment? Like, our job as a church, in Hebrews it says to look after each other so that none of you fails to receive the grace of God. Watch out that no poisonous, see that word, poisonous root of bitterness, poisonous root of resentment grows up to trouble you and then to infect or corrupt the people around you. Bitterness, it's destroying our country. It's destroying our families. It's destroying our churches. It'll destroy you and all that you love. And at the end of the day, I need God's grace. I need God's grace in my life to help me with that resentment when it's not going my way, to go, okay, this is undeserved blessing that he's given me. And the truth is, you need it too. And so do all of those people out there that drive you and me crazy. We all need it. Now, that doesn't mean just ignore your anger, and it doesn't mean just ignore the things that are wrong with our world. It's just don't let it become resentment. It's a terrible way to live. So if you're dealing with that, man, now's the time to let God into that space. To let others in, to share it with others, invite them into your inner world. I mean, that may mean for some of you joining a group now, like trying it out. Get yourself surrounded by some life-giving friends. And I know what some of your men are thinking. You're like, I don't talk to people about my problems. That's what women do. That's a lot, you know, it's like, that's what they do. And so if you need an event to help you at least get a little more connected with some of the other guys at our church, here's one that's coming up at the end of October. It's Blues and Barbecue. We're going to have Travis Rosin speaking. He's from American Ninja Warrior. And it's just going to be a time where you're going to hear him share his story, his faith journey. But our hope is to help you get shoulder to shoulder with some other guys at the church and to see how you need a band of brothers to help you journey this life. And so go to cedarcreek.tv/mensevent, or you can go to our app to sign up. It's right on the homepage there. We would love to have you there. It's going to be a good time. And even if you're not into all of this stuff, it's an easy way for you to get connected with some other guys that are a part of our church. So I hope you do that. The question for all of us is, what's the step that God's inviting you to take today? Maybe there's a vice that you need to bring to the cross. It's like a character flaw. Like, I've been struggling with this and I'm going to surrender it to you. Maybe there's an apology that you need to give somebody. Reach out right now. Pull out your phone, text them. Hey, can we talk? I owe you an apology for the way that I lashed out at you over that or whatever. Maybe there's forgiveness that you need to extend. Light a candle. Just say, you're marking a moment. I don't want this bitterness and resentment to define my life. Maybe you need to replace resentment with God's grace. You could do that at the communion table. You remember Christ's body and blood shed for you, out of love for you, something that you couldn't earn, you don't deserve, and we need to receive that. Maybe you need prayer. Maybe you need to look for a group. Whatever that step is, I want to invite you to do that right now. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the invitation to look humbly and honestly at the anger in our life. And so God, we ask that your Spirit speak in this moment. Help us to see what we need to see. Bring clarity to where we need to take a step. God, help us to acknowledge our anger and not just ignore it, but also not let it dictate our life. Help us to have the courage and maturity to get curious and to see what's really wrong. And God, to ask the question, what's the wise thing to do in light of what we have just discovered? And God, we trust that your Spirit is gonna guide us. And so whatever step that needs to be taken today, would you give each individual the courage to do that? And at the very least, help us to reflect on these words that invite us to surrender and entrust our life to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
So as Ben said, we're going to just have some time just to reflect today. And so I wanted to give you just a little bit of direction as to where the response stations are in the room. And so today, if you want to light a candle during this next moment, you can go to the back right of the auditorium. You can do that there. If you want to engage through giving today, you can do that in the back middle of the room. Maybe today you just want to take communion. You can go to the back left of the room and do that. If today you need prayer, our prayer team would love to pray with and for you down to the right at the cross. And maybe today you just need to surrender something. If you want to come to the cross right down here to the left, you can write that down, you can pin that up there, and you can surrender that today. And that's really what this next moment is about. It's just reminding ourselves of our desperate need of who God is, and that we need to daily surrender to him, whatever that looks like for you. So over the next few minutes, I just want to encourage you just to take a step today to respond to who he is as we sing together.
Down on my knees again, surrendering all, surrendering all. And find me here, Lord, as you draw me near. I'm desperate for you. Desperate for you, and I surrender. Entrench my soul. Mercy and grace unfold. I hunger and thirst. I hunger and thirst. With arms stretched wide, I know you hear my cry. Speak to me. Speak to me now, and I surrender, I surrender, I want to know you more, I want to know you more, I surrender. Rushing wind, Jesus, breathe with.
I hope you enjoyed that service, the worship portion and the message, and let it be a spark for you going into this week and remembering the bottom line, that anger is a signal, not a solution, right? Like most emotions, it's a signal, not a solution. We want to come alongside you when talking about emotions, and we want to prepare things to help you take a positive step in your emotional and mental well-being, which is why we started the text campaign of 60 days to better emotional health. If you want to take part in that, we'll send you 2 text messages a week, not a day. I think last week I told you we would send 2 text messages a day. Nobody wants that. But 2 a week, we'll send you some positive, encouraging, Christ-centered resources to help you with your emotional and mental health. It's our 60 days to better mental health. You can text the word better to 419-419-0707 to take part in that campaign. And then lastly, I want to push groups again, because groups is where it's at. That is where we can let others in and share the things that we're struggling with, the things that we're celebrating, and bring others alongside on our journey. And so if you have not been a part of a group, I would encourage you to check out the directory. You can text the word groups to 419-419-0707, or you can visit us at cedarcreek.tv/groups and check out the directory. There's literally a group for everything. There's groups in person and online. So I want to encourage you to check out the directory. For now, I hope you have a great weekend, a great week, and I look forward to seeing you next week.